The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, I would prefer short and succinct questions and answers to match. And question number one, I call Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is giving to NHS boards that are under pressure.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
As members will be aware, the health and care system is under extreme pressure due to the pandemic, and all health boards are experiencing significant issues, including workforce challenges and high levels of delayed discharge. As members will know, we've invested an additional £300 million, a package of measures to support health and social care services over the course of the winter period. Over and above that, and to maximise capacity during winter, we've invested £10 million in two new specialist programmes that aim to provide alternatives to admission and that our processes are right to ensure timely discharge.
Stephen Kerr.
I begin by paying tribute to everyone who's working on the front line in our NHS, but I was really hoping we might get more about the measures the government is taking to give immediate practical support to the health boards and our frontline NHS staff and our care staff indeed. The winter plan should be about practical support, not press releases. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how many people are waiting for a care package to be discharged from hospital, and what is the longest time people have been waiting to be discharged?
Cabinet Secretary.
What I would say to Stephen Kerr, I'll get him the exact figures, forgive me, I don't have them to the top of my hand, but he's actually right, of course, to focus on the issue of delayed discharge. That is where that £300 million of investment, and it isn't just press releases, and I think he would know that. It is, of course, practical action. And what we're looking to do through that practical action is, for example, recruit 1,000 band 2 to 4s. Those individuals will help us for those that are waiting for care at home. What we're also looking to do is fund care home placements, interim care home placements. So again, where those individuals who are clinically safe to discharge will be discharged. So I meet health boards on a very regular basis. I've got a range of meetings this afternoon, tomorrow afternoon, with those health boards that have the highest numbers of delayed discharges. And I can promise them that practical action is what I hope is making a difference. And it's maybe why, although figures are nowhere near where we would like them to be, it's maybe why for the last 3 weeks we've seen an improvement in NHS performance.
Stephen Kerr.
With the grace of respect to the Cabinet Secretary, those numbers should be at the front of his mind, because he's absolutely right to identify this as a critical challenge facing our NHS. And the fact that he doesn't know those numbers is deeply disappointing. The government has been talking for weeks about the approaching crisis, and what we are listening to now, Presiding Officer, is simply the product of SNP neglect of our NHS and care system. It seems that the Cabinet Secretary is asleep at the wheel and he needs to get a grip. If I may ask him, yesterday, the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Glasgow offered the Cabinet Secretary realistic solutions to workforce planning. Their president, Professor Jackie Taylor, said, "It's no secret that COVID-19 has placed unrelenting pressures on an already fractured healthcare system." However, these challenges existed long before the pandemic. Staff shortages and excessive workloads are nothing new. The workforce is in crisis, and the urgency in the need to address this cannot be overstated. Does the Cabinet Secretary disagree with Professor Taylor?
Cabinet Secretary.
I have a good relationship with Professor Taylor and look forward to meeting her again. And no, of course, I will continue to engage with Royal Colleges. And I don't disagree that there was challenges pre-pandemic. I think it would be absurd or foolish for anybody to suggest, and I certainly have never suggested, First Minister, or indeed this government has never suggested, that there haven't been issues pre-pandemic. But also it would be equally absurd, I suspect, for anybody to suggest that the biggest shock that our NHS has ever faced in its 73-year history does not have a bearing on the outcome as we see today. He asked me for a very specific figure. Of course, I know the number of standard delays. There are 1,500 standard delays. He asked me a very specific figure of those that are waiting, I think, a care home package or waiting to be assessed. So I'll get him that exact figure. And if he wants it broken down by health board, I'll do my best to give him that figure in detail too. But I don't accept his characterisation in relation to this government's action on the NHS. We have highest staffing numbers ever in the history of the NHS under this government. 9 years of consecutive growth, record investment, the highest single pay deal ever for NHS staff. They are the best paid staff in any part of the UK. And although, of course, I want these statistics to be higher, and that's what we're working hard on, we still do have the best performing A&E, and that has been the case for 6 years in a row.
Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I understand that various schemes have been put in place to provide support to NHS staff. who are working incredibly hard in the face of the pressure caused by the pandemic. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with NHS Lanarkshire staff that COVID is still with us and the best thing that we all can do to support our healthcare workers and protect the NHS is to get vaccinated?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I agree with that wholeheartedly. Tribute to the staff at, across the NHS, right across the country, for their incredible efforts during the pandemic. They've been nothing short of Herculean. But Colette Stevenson is absolutely right. Of course, she's absolutely right. That the best thing that we can do in order to help our NHS and protect our NHS is get vaccinated. We know the protection that the vaccine offers. We should make sure that we rigorously follow those baseline mitigation measures, such as wearing face coverings in appropriate settings unless you're exempt. Test yourself regularly, practice good hygiene, and all of these measures can help us to get COVID more under control, as we know that the numbers that we have that we're dealing with at the moment are far too high. And if we do all of that, that of course can help to alleviate the pressure on our NHS and help those who are working so courageously and tirelessly in our NHS.
Paul O'Kane.
I asked the Cabinet Secretary last week about the cancellation of surgeries, particularly cancer surgeries, as NHS boards struggle under immense pressure. The Cabinet Secretary pointed to the challenges of the pandemic, but we know that waiting lists have been growing for years. Indeed, elective surgery is also a concern, and people are struggling in pain for long periods of time. What is the Cabinet Secretary doing to support NHS boards to enable surgery to recommence, and that we want practical measures such as increasing bed capacity and listening to the recommendations of the Royal Colleges?
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, we will listen to the Royal College. Just on cancer performance, it's worth saying that for the quarter ending June 2021, 97.9% of cancer patients started treatment within 31 days of decision to treat. So that 31-day target was met. We know it's more challenging for that 62-day target. So that's why a lot of our investment goes into the diagnostic piece. And that's why I was pleased that the government has invested in 3 early cancer diagnostic centres in various different health boards across the country. We'll evaluate them. If they are going well, giving us the results that we expect to see, then we will consider rolling them out further. In terms of more practical support, I've already referenced the fact that we're recruiting more staff to the NHS and we'll continue to do that. So we have immediate pressures, but I think Paul O'Kane is right to mention the fact that there are also long-term pressures in terms of recovery, and that's why we have a recovery plan backed by £1 billion of investment.
Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have concerns about the booster rollout in NHS Lanarkshire. There are reportedly nearly 5,000 housebound people in the health board area who are waiting for their boosters. And I've also been contacted by constituents who are housebound but have not been registered as such, and so have been given appointments at vaccination centres which they cannot possibly attend. Will the Cabinet Secretary look into this matter, and if there is any further support that can be provided to NHS Lanarkshire to help work through the backlog?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I will, of course, look at any information and details that Gillian Mackay provides of particular constituents, but on the general point, of course, I will raise that. I spoke to NHS Lanarkshire, both the Chief Executive and the Chair, yesterday. We went into quite a fair bit of detail on the autumn-winter vaccination programme, and they did reference the fact that they were looking to increase the number of doses administered over the festive period. But if there are very specific individual constituency cases she wishes me to look at, of course I will do that.
Question number 2, Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how many schools are currently shut due to staff shortages resulting from COVID-19 cases.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann Somerville.
We receive daily management information from local authorities that provides their intelligence of which schools in their area are closed due to COVID reasons or are at risk of closure. For example, last week local authorities informed us of a total of 4 schools across Scotland who were closed at some stage. As of yesterday, that reporting indicated that 1 school was closed. This management information does not, however, include a detailed breakdown of the reasons for a school closure, and the responsibility for such decisions sits with local authorities. We know that all parts of the system have been stretched as they've responded to the pressures of the pandemic, and for that reason we have already committed £240 million to supporting local authorities to recruit additional teachers and staff to deploy more support to their schools, children and families. This investment has supported the appointment of an additional 2,200 teachers and more than 500 support staff in schools across Scotland.
Martin Whitfield.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that, and indeed the Cabinet Secretary has confirmed just now that 2,200 new teachers have been recruited, but we are also in a period of teacher shortage with cases rising and normal winter illness rates just about to hit. And this is causing schools having to close to year groups and worse. So how will the Scottish Government mitigate the number of teachers who are absent?
Cabinet Secretary.
We do appreciate that there are operational challenges for many schools as they continue to deal with the challenges that COVID does prevent them. These are obviously discussed at the Education Recovery Group every time that meets, and we take that, as a government, we take that very seriously. Schools can take decisions to close a year group, for example, if that is the right response in their eyes to the operational challenges that they have. I should point out that when we're actually looking at the number of new positive cases when it comes to pupils, we are seeing, for example, just under 50% of schools not having any cases being reported when we look at what's happening between P1, P7, S1 and S4. And for example, 17% have only one case. There are very few that have a multitude of cases or what might be classed as an outbreak. So absolutely, we look very seriously at what needs to be done to support teachers. I've discussed some of the national issues in my original answer, and we keep very closely up to date with both local authorities and trade unions to ensure if there's anything more can be done, we are happy to do so.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful. Scottish Labour and these benches have been highlighting about the need for proper ventilation in schools for over a year now, and yet the Scottish Government still doesn't know how many classrooms failed at the inspection. Children are again this winter being advised to wear coats and gloves while windows are open. So what is the Scottish Government going to do to improve the environment in pupils' classrooms and teachers and classroom assistants and others' place of work?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member will be aware that the Scottish Government has provided £90 million in the early days of the pandemic to support schools in a variety of issues, and that included supported for ventilation. That was followed by another £10 million to support schools to ensure that all local authorities undertook monitoring of the teaching areas within their schools. That is being completed, and local authorities are then responsible for dealing with any maintenance issues that have came to light from that. I would stress that what has came to light in these have been quite minor issues, very much in the main, but we of course keep in very close contact still with the local authorities to ensure that work is being undertaken and continues to be undertaken where necessary. Natural ventilation will play an important part of that. That's not Scottish Government deciding that, but that's very much looking at the expert advice that's coming in specifically to deal with ventilation. But we will continue to ensure that we do keep a close eye on that to support schools with the ongoing monitoring that we will need over the winter months.
Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I share Martin Whitfield's concerns about the impact, albeit temporary, of recent classroom closures and note the return of home-based learning at Ross High in Trenent and for 9 classes at Preston Tower Primary School in East Lothian. Pupils in S4, S5 and S6 are set to sit crucial exams next year, and despite the heroic efforts of teachers, Scotland Young Pupils have already seen their learning negatively affected by lockdowns. So will the Minister now commit to tackling ongoing teacher shortages, and what is this Government going to do to support councils to assist schools such as Ross High, which may be subject to disruption or class closure due to COVID and the SNP's teacher shortages?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I referred in my original answer to the additional 2,200 teachers and 500 support staff that the Scottish Government is already providing the financial support to local authorities for, and that will be paying dividends across the country. We absolutely do recognise that there will still be challenges in terms of either pupil or teacher absence, and that's exactly why the SQA announced before the summer modifications to the national qualifications for 2022 and also investigated and is continuing to investigate the modifications that may have to be put in place if there was significantly more disruption than we saw last year. We are not at that stage. Clearly, these discussions don't just happen within the SQA or indeed within government, but with our stakeholders to ensure that stakeholders, particularly including young people, but parents and teachers as well, are part of the process of ensuring that young people can be reassured that they will have a credible qualifications process next year, and the government and the SQA will support them through that.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.